If I may, I would like to introduce my voice first. 17 years ago now, when I was working for TIFID in East Africa and Uganda, I was diagnosed with what I was told was inoperable and incurable throat cancer. That was 17 years ago. So the first lesson for this panel is don't believe the experts. As Stephen said, I work at the moment in Australia, and my job is to try to interpret a lot of what Michael was saying for the Australian aid program in one of the most difficult governance environments in the world, and that's Papua New Guinea. There's only three countries in the world that has not achieved any of the sustainable of the MDGs. Papua New Guinea is one of them. The other two were North Korea and Zimbabwe. So most of my time is spent grappling with the sorts of questions that Michael was addressing. In Michael's presentation, he asked the question, and I wrote it down. To what extent is PDIA thinking and working politically, doing development differently? Is this a new way of addressing the questions of institutional development? So in this session, I want to ask our panelists basically two questions. First of all, is it a new way? And secondly, given the political economy of the organizations where we work, to what extent is it actually feasible? Michael mentioned the questions that face all of us in our work. We know about institutions that take a long time. They emerge, they're domestically driven, and they're context specific. As a result of that, this movement in the last 3 or 4 years has emerged. And there are three sets of abbreviations that sort of try to capture that. Michael mentioned PDIA, problem-driven iterative adaptation. That led to what is called the Doing Development Differently movement out of Harvard. If you go to the Harvard website and look at Doing Development Differently, there's a manifesto there that explains what it's about. In parallel to the DDD movement, there's this thinking and working politically international community of practice, which I sort of run. There are common themes between those three sets of abbreviations. They are addressing the same sorts of questions, the same sorts of problems. And these movements, if we're going to call them that, they've arisen partly in recognition of the fact that institutions take years, they're unpredictable. They've also partly arisen as a result of the project framework that Michael was talking about. Now, there are differences between those three sets of abbreviations, PDIA, DDD, and thinking and working politically, but there's far more that unites them than divides them. They focus on the problem, not the solution. They focus on adaptive management, which I'd like to get Melissa to talk about. They're much less prescriptive on what can be delivered year by year. They engage with particular interests. They ask that organizations funding change, make explicit their value base, and try to encourage that process of change. So the real question is, to what extent does this represent a different way of doing development? And are development organizations like the bank, like TFAT, USAID, to what extent are they up for this sort of organizational change? So to discuss these questions, we've got a very illustrious panel. On my extreme left, Charles Cadwell, Director for the Center for International Development and Governance at the Urban Institute here in Washington. Juan Pardinas, Director of the Center for Competitiveness in Mexico, and Melissa Brown, Abt acting deputy assistant administrator with
USAID.
Say
it better than I do.
So I would like each of you just to give a quick sort of summary in 3 or 4 minutes of what this agenda says to you. Does it resonate, first of all, on an individual level, and then for your organization?
I'm glad that Graham started with the question of individually, is this new? And then organizationally, is this new? Because I may have slightly different answers to those questions. Individually, I mean, this isn't new, and I'm sure a number of us feel this way. We are just part of this long arc of history, as Michael said so well, of focusing on these issues. I joined USAID about 23 or so years ago to help create a center of gravity in the agency to better understand democratic governance, challenges on the ground, and how to incorporate those challenges into our strategies and programs. That work continued in better understanding, because of the volatile environments we work in, how you understand conflict, how you understand grievances and drivers, and then continuing on to issues of fragile states and the like. So when you have that kind of focus to your work, of course you're thinking, and you're thinking politically, you're working politically all the time. And there's a whole cadre of people now at USAID and in the broader community who do as well. However, what we're talking about, I think, is to draw those lessons and experiences more into other sectors, and more into countrywide and regional-wide analysis. And that's where we are really being intentional, have been and being intentional as an agency in looking as a tool for thinking and working politically, looking at applied political economy analysis. The centerpiece of that effort is to really enable others working across the agency to analyze the political economy of their environments, whether they are analyzing a country, a sector, or a development problem, and then think how that understanding can better inform. And I hope that the wonkish nature of what I'm about to say will be encouraging in the spirit of what Michael said. It is, when you get to that, it means you're starting to operationalize this work. So what we're about is better drawing that understanding into what we call the program cycle at USAID, into our strategic planning efforts, into our project design efforts, into implementation, and bringing that and connecting that to other models for how you manage and learn from that work going forward. I hope we have a chance today to talk about what we're doing in the area of adaptive management. You had brought that up as well. We're doing this work in several countries. There's much more work to be done, but our country experience with this stretches from Liberia to Madagascar to Indonesia. So we are building, working with you, a body of experience and learning in this area. I would just highlight in a minute some of the other specific things that we are doing, because as I noted, this is a work in progress to operationalize this agenda. Of course, we are training our staff and encouraging others and training them on how to bring a thinking and working politically lens to their work. We are collaborating with other parts of USAID and thinking about their roles and how we can support, whether it be our policy shop, our contracting officers, or our development lab. We're engaging regularly with other sectors. With health specialists, with economic growth specialists, with our food security colleagues. We, as I noted, are developing a model and deepening a model of adaptive management, which isn't just a concept, but also digging in, again, to what Michael was talking about, how we get into the guts of our operations and our mechanisms so that we can adjust as political economy on the ground adjusts. And then lastly, we are really looking to build strong relationships with people like yourselves and an explicit learning agenda so we can draw out the experience of the community more broadly. So in that vein, certainly happy to be here with this panel.
Thank you, Melissa. In the next round of questions, I'll come back to you on some of the implications for that, but thank you.
Thank you very much, Graham. Thank you for ABT to the opportunity to share the work we have done in Mexico. I work in a policy think tank, like a traditional policy think tank, but in 2014, as a country, we faced quite a shock. There was a huge scandal that the family residence of the president of Mexico was financed by a government contractor. And the corruption issues start to scale in the government, and we address the corruption problem in Mexico as the main problem of the development, of the lack of development and the lack of growth in the economy. So what could we do on the face of these facts at the end of 2014? Then the whole investigation around the presidential case basically brought the fact that he didn't break any law because the legislation did not force him to present a conflict of interest declaration. So, we basically needed as a country to reshuffle the framework of how to address conflict of interest. There was not even a basic format that civil servants, public officials, or the president of Mexico had to fill. This was so bad that in a meeting with the Mexican chapter of Transparency International, we were reviewing the formats that civil servants have to fill in conflict of interest all around the world. No? We did a Google search, like conflict of interest format. Okay, let's see what happens in the US, what happens in Chile, what happens in the UK. And we drafted this format. And like after 2 weeks that we presented this format in a public conference, someone from the government called my office, said, okay, could you help us to draft the format? And I was going like, whoa, I did a Google search and attend a meeting for 2 hours, and now I'm the national expert on this issue. but we found that there were a lot of grievances and not like the political will we wanted to see to push these issues forward. So in 2014, Mexico had a constitutional reform that for the first time in history, not only the president of the members of Congress could start legislation, citizens could also start legislation if you managed to get 120,000 signatures. So decide, well, let's draft legislation about conflict of interest and what the public should expect. So we thought it will take us 3 months to write the legislation. Actually, it took us almost 9. But at the end of the day, the piece of legislation we drafted was supported by the major law departments in the country. It had academic background, people from the civil service who gave us their views, and us as the think tank community and the civil society community. So then we presented to the public exactly 1 year ago in February and asked to get 120,000 signatures. We didn't have much money to the for the campaign, but we had Twitter and we had Facebook. 2 months later, we managed to get not 120,000 signatures, but 630,000 signatures with no money spent campaigning. So in this effort of thinking and working politically in the different way, we presented the legislation to Congress. And it was kind of endearing how members of Congress behaved with us. They were nice, but we were kind of this awkward Chinese base that your uncle gave away in Christmas and you don't know what to do with it, but you know. And they say, well, these are this civil society think tank people. Where should we sit them? Are there legislators? No, they are not, but they drafted a law that has 600,000 signatures and a lot of press around. What should we do with them? Well, and at the same time, we were not very good at the confidence level with our members of Congress. It was a complicated process, but at the end, like 80% of what we drafted was approved. And the country sort of moved in the right direction. I totally agree with what Michael said, that sometimes you have excellent laws and then you have a huge gap between the good laws and the enforcement. But I found myself of being in the recipient part of the criticism now, because people that got to sign the legislation or make a huge effort to get 100 or 500 signatures, now they're coming to me and said, well, corruption problems are still there. What happened with our law? I said, well, this is complex. You know, it takes time. And sometimes I found myself giving the same kind of explanations and apologies that I usually hear from civil servants, members of Congress, and government officials. And we're living in very interesting, but at the same time, very difficult times. Because what happens to an ordinary person in Mexico? They go into their jobs, they go into their phones, they go into their computers, they use Google. What was the last time people in the room used Google? Maybe yesterday, maybe 2 days ago. And what happens with Google? They give us very fast answers. Whatever we want, it's in Google. Our lives are solved through Google. But government is not Google. And the Congress is not Google. And reality is not Google. But people's expectations run much more faster than the possibility to bring results, to bring an arc of change. So for now we are in this uncomfortable position that we are civil society, we are a think tank, but now we're giving these kind of answers that we were quite bored about and quite frustrated about, because change needs patience, and patience is something we all are kind of losing, giving in the technology community how fast results are presented, how things are solved in such an easy way. And that's not how change comes, not in the political space, not in the development space. So how do we communicate these complexities of change to societies that expect results much more faster? That I don't know, but I'm very happy to be here to learn about it.
Thanks, Juan. Chaz.
Well, thank you, Graham, and thank you to Abt for convening all of us. It's a little bit like old home week, so many familiar faces in the room. Listening to Juan's comment, I'm remembering my first trip to Mongolia in January of 1990. They had a brand new government. They had no company law. They had no bankruptcy law. They had no private property. But in the dark of winter, when it was 20 below zero, there were people hard at work converting a children's theater in their version of Red Square to a stock exchange, because they were going to be a market economy. We're going to have shares. We're going to trade them, whatever they are. And the phrase that Michael and his co-authors use in their book is isomorphic mimicry. These are people who wanted to be modern. And so their definition of the problem was, we don't have a stock exchange. 15 years later, I was in Cairo, where the USAID at that point had invested millions in building a modern stock exchange. No company law, no bankruptcy law, no courts to enforce any of those. And so this issue for me, so to your question, Graham, is this new? The problems certainly aren't new. The attention is, I think, and that's to be applauded. But one of the challenges we face, I think, is that we don't yet agree on what the problems are. Whether it's TWP or PDIA, we're trying to expanding the definition of the problems to include a broader set of concerns. And so if you think about the source of a problem, there's a set of nested institutional arrangements. And so the stories Michael was telling about the schools in Palestine, those are institutions within the scope and the reach of that principal in her community. Lots of the other problems we wrestle with are layered in a whole set of rules, laws, norms, constitutions, social values that change at very, very different paces. And so as practitioners, it's very, very hard to take account of those. I was looking yesterday at this very interesting and lengthy World Development Report this year, which talks about laws and norms and these sorts of issues. And as I was looking at all the examples they had of good things happening, they were all phrased as, this can happen, this may happen. None of us live in a may and can world. We live in a world where we have to say will happen. If you're an aid or a World Bank program designer, you have to say, if we do this, X will happen. if you're, when Michael was talking, I was trying to think about, gosh, if we were to write a response to an RFP that says, we're going to fail for the first 1,000 times we try this. So if you give us 10,000 times, we're going to get it right. You know, none of us will be in business. But that is the essence of it. And so to me, this idea that we need to be thinking about not just what's the problem, but what's the nest of problems, and what tools do we have. And so the whether it's the USAID's political economy framework or a PDIA approach, to basically asking layers of why. Doctors and nurses aren't using their training. Well, why? Well, it's because they don't have, they're not observed by their peers the way they are in more congested places. Well, why is that? And so just kept asking why. And then that leads us, but also our counterparts, to then see the problems differently. And to me, that's the innovation. It's innovation not just for us outsiders, but it's innovation for our counterparts. Because if you think your problem is a lack of a stock exchange, it takes some learning to think that the problem is, in fact, a bunch of other things. And that you may want to work on some of those issues earlier. At the Urban Institute, we're spending a lot of our time worrying about subnational governments and service delivery, where, again, you have the very same issue. The people in the local governments don't have the capacity to manage these services. They don't understand public financial management. They don't have computers. So the tendency is to address that front-facing problem, as opposed to, well, why do you expect them to use the computer? Or if their appointments come from the central government, or if the teachers are hired and fired someplace else, or procurement is it's a nest of problems, and the fact that the water doesn't come out of the tap is not simply a matter of putting pipes in the ground and having, now, you may want to do that, but you ought not to expect that to change the system. And at the end of the day, we're about trying to help people accelerate history and change systems that serve people better.
Okay, thank you, Chaz. And I want to ask a specific question of each of the panelists before I open it up to everybody in the room. So I guess my first question is for Melissa. If you look at the detailed recommendations of doing development differently, PDIA, thinking and working politically, the major features are a lack of specificity and much less prescription in how you're going to deliver whatever your development initiative is. Michael emphasized the fact that doing development differently focuses on the problem, a relentless focus on the problem, and a parallel awareness of what the goal is that you're trying to achieve. But how you get there is much less specified. Try lots of different bets in the language of PDIA. So if you try to apply that in practice, what it means for donor agencies and contractors is that when you implement something, you're collapsing a number of things into one process. If you're just focusing on the problem and you are much less specific about how you're going to get there, then you are doing the design, the implementation, and the learning all at the same time. So my question, Melissa, and it's a very unfair one, but you're on the panel, so why not?
I knew what I was getting.
Have we got to development organizations have the skills, the competencies to design, implement, and monitor in real time, to learn and change and adapt as they go? That seems to me a very sophisticated set of skills.
Absolutely, and it's going to take time to get there. I think part of it is realizing that you need to get there and to put in the expectations clearly and to communicate those clearly. So, as I had noted, let me step back for a minute, actually, because I do think we are throwing around different phrases, but I do think that they are part of a coherent system. Thinking and working politically means that you need to understand the, let's just use the phrase political economy, nuances, where you are operating. To understand those nuances, You need to be working closely, listening to, relying upon local expertise. That is something that we have prioritized in terms of doing the analysis as an agency, to draw on local think tanks, to draw on our local staff in our aid missions around the world, and to not just have that result in a report that sits on the table or the bookshelf, but is actually drawn upon, updated, and the updating doesn't have to be continuing to do heavy report after heavy report. It can be through easy tools that people use when they go out into the environment, have their meetings, implement their programs, et cetera. So it's really, that is a sort of an essential part of the foundation. Part of also what aid has really lifted up is ensuring that we are setting expectations and communicating them for a model of adaptive management that, if you think about it, was really born out of our experience in more complex, volatile environments. But we've appreciated as a community that model is very relevant, of course, to more stable development settings. What we have done to set those expectations, and this is going to get wonky again, is we have included as one of our four foundational principles the expectation that adaptive management will be used in designing, implementing, and reevaluating the success of our programs. The reason why I say it's wonky is that is enshrined in what we call our automated directive system. Not the type of thing that all of us sort of leap up and say we're going to influence at the beginning of the day, but in aid, that's very significant because that is the resource that our program officers, our officers designing programs on the ground, use in order to do their work. We also have appreciated that in order to be deliberate about adaptive management, we need to communicate expectations and develop models for CLA, collaborative learning. And that is a process where we now have a few models from around the world of where our staff, this is my language, hit the pause button regularly and take stock from their stakeholders, whether they are achieving the results and whether their environment's changing and whether we need to make changes and whether we need to adjust our programs. Then I think Michael said something very important. The conversation has to be with, include up front and throughout, those who ensure that we can deliver our programs, our contracting officers, our Office of Assistance and Acquisition. And so that office we also are working with so that we can develop mechanisms and innovate to be able to have our instruments change on the ground without going through lengthy processes of changing those. So the acronym is OAA, they have actually established hubs around the world where they are also trying to collect best practice and innovation. So this is a very long answer to your question, but I think it signals that it's not just one piece of this that we are taking on. We really are trying to connect all aspects of our analysis, planning, and operations in order to adapt in these settings. Just one comment that Chaz, you had made me appreciate. I think what we also need to do, and in my previous job as head of the Office of Conflict Management and Mitigation, we did a lot of work on theories of change. Just because you are working in an environment that's changing frequently and you're reassessing that doesn't mean that you don't have theories of change that are informing your program design. And you can and need to go back and tailor and tweak those as well. But you know, that certainly can be part of the process. Doesn't have to be laborious, but it can certainly be part of the process as well.
Okay, thanks, Melissa. Another feature of PDIA TWP is the emphasis on adaptive management, as we've just been talking about. And if I could just give one example of a discussion I had with some colleagues at the World Bank, and I asked them, to what extent are the bank's procedures, to what extent do they allow you to adapt and reassign inputs redesignate targets year by year. And a very good friend of mine gave a fantastic answer. She said, yes, of course, the bank can do that. We can flexibly respond to the situation as long as it coincides with the midterm review. So, Chaz, my question to you is...
The water's me.
Sorry. My question to you is... With, you mentioned isomorphic mimicry, and another feature of this movement, if it is a movement, is, as Michael said, a focus on best fit, not good practice. Institutions are context-specific, country-specific, domestically led and driven. My question is then, if we jettison the idea of best practice, then what signposts have we got for institutional design? Does it mean that every country we go to, we've got to make it up from first principles? How do we get around the fact that we need some sort of normative organizational model to provide advice? We can't invent everything from first principles everywhere we go.
That's an interesting question. You know, Michael said that in 200 years from now, or 1,000 years from now, I forget what you said, we'll still be talking about these issues because we don't, in fact, have an algorithm that we can apply universally. If you were a doctor and two twins walked into your office, both complaining about a fever, it would be malpractice to talk to the first one and prescribe the same thing to both. And we do a little bit of that. We say, well, we did our last place I was, we did a stock exchange project. It worked great. The Czechs are trading stocks. Let's do it in Mongolia. So I don't think it's a bivariate choice that we're talking about, because there are things, we all have experience. And the people we're working with have ambitions and things they want to do. And the issue is not how do we impose our idea, how do we help them realize their idea or adapt their idea. I think the problem becomes when we have to put metrics to things. We all need to be accountable. And so we end up being accountable for, did you pass the law? Did you deliver that much vitamin A? Is the water coming out of the tap? And I think there's a more fundamental set of metrics that we don't have good tools for yet that sort of capture more important signposts that are more broadly universal. And I think about those as when we're done, are people engaging in collective decision-making in a different way than they were when we came? Are different people sitting at the table? I mean, how many people have seen Hamilton, the song, Want to Be in the Room Where It Happens? Are there different people in the room where it happens? Is a important metric. And that's an outcome that's sort of deeper and beyond the issue of did you do the first facing problem. Secondly, is there information or has your intervention changed the way key actors think about the problem? Have we changed their frame of thinking? What the PDIA process does is help people rethink about the nature of the problem and their interest in it. To my domestic policy days here, until someone put a number on the cost of trucking regulation, it was impossible to change it here in this country. But when it became clear that it cost every American family $105 a year to subsidize Teamsters and license holders, that unblocked things in Congress. And then the third metric I guess I would use is, have we undermined some monopoly on information or resources that exist around the problem we're dealing with? Because that's often, to my view, the problem. And those are very difficult things to put into an RFP or to put into a proposal to work with an agency. But to my mind, if projects start, projects end, programs start and end. But at the end of the day, we're talking about those fundamental functional processes within a society.
Thank you. Now, Juan, in your introductory remarks, you gave an excellent example of how change came about as a result of basically a political process. So my question to you is, to what extent do you think external actors, be it the bank, be it USAID, be it TIFID, TFAT, whoever, to what extent do you think it's feasible, realistic, that they can work politically in the way that you did to bring about change? Is it just unrealistic to expect that they'll be so explicit in trying to change the balance of power in a particular country? To what extent is it a realistic agenda for external partners, this thinking and working politically approach?
I think external partners are key to these processes. In a way, I think the best approach is how external partners could bring steroids to internal reformers. And sometimes internal reformers do need help, do need friends, do need support from outside the political pressure and dynamics and kind of local conversations. During this process, it was all not pretty last year. I got my phone tapped, for example. My wife got her phone tapped. And the worst thing that happened, they basically tried to destroy my family. Someone that was not was kind of angry and started sending us messages and then letting us know that the conversations we are having. The best thing I did on that period was going to a public presentation with the U.S. ambassador. A picture with the U.S. ambassador on that context was really helpful. Just a picture, just for me being there with the kind of right support from abroad, help domestically send the right message that, well, this effort belongs to a larger community, to a larger set of conversation, and we should kind of have a different kind of opposition towards it. So for organizations that are driving change, support could come in so many different forms. Sometimes you get a lot of pressure from your back just for sending the right, conveying the right kind of message that you're not alone. And it could, that kind of support could come in so many forms, but it's needed because sometimes you cannot find support, that support nationally. And I see it from a different perspective within the scope of Mexico. Mexico, it's a federal country. The same example that Charles made about the theater in Mongolia, I could use it for the federalist system in Mexico and in some other countries. We read about Hamilton, Jay Madison, wow, this is a great idea. Let's build the theater here. Let's build federalism in a country that it's so diverse, so different from one region to the other, and we will use this federal system that sounds like a very good idea to organize our territory in a political shape. But when you find out that the country is so diverse, people in some parts of Mexico come and see us, a think tank in Mexico City, as outside help, and say, please join and please take a picture with us so we could send the message to the local powers in Oaxaca or the local powers in Hidalgo that we are part of a bigger network of organizations that IMCO from Mexico City support us. That would be a key for our local processes in our community. So there is a chain of support from the outside to these kind of organizations and from the inside for an organization of like IMCO to our local partners in different parts of the country. So I, despite of the, all these risks of trying to help from the distance, the help is widely appreciated and it could materialize in so many ways and so many forms.
I'm Cinnamon Dornseif. I'm on the board of directors of Abt Associates, and my question is for Chaz. We've talked a lot about these new indicators. You mentioned some of them. Michael mentioned a new way of analyzing our impact and asking new questions and new indicators. The question is, What about the broader audience out there? We're talking to ourselves. Don't we need to convince the broader world of the complexity, and how do we do that?
It's a difficult question, Simon. I've been working at this stuff since, this is my second career, but working since 1990 when I started with Mansour Olson out at the University of Maryland. And you know, this week I'm trying to recruit somebody to join my team to work on, you know, local government and service delivery, and looking for that political economy plus. And I've got a bunch of really smart people, but there are not many yet that are owning the political economy space. And that's a, you know, I worry a little bit that by giving the things an acronym, PEA, PDEIA, TWP, we make it a thing. It's not a thing. It's a way of thinking. It's a way of approaching a problem. And not all of us are born that way or trained that way. To your question of how you communicate these things, you know, we don't need to have everybody on the planet knowing our acronyms. We need people to think about problems in a way. And so there are, and there's different elites. You know, if you're working it, but with the school in rural Palestine, you don't need people in Missouri to be thinking about your problem. You need to people there to be thinking freshly about their problem and being empowered to have solutions. You know, Melissa's work in AID, you know, they're pioneers sitting in this Dacha Bureau, I guess. you know, that's a teeny tiny part of this huge ocean liner of people who are trained to think in a different way. And so they're doing the sorts of things that you would do with that elite that is setting aid policy and programming. And so I think, you know, to me, there's dramatically greater appreciation for the fact that these governance institutions matter than there were when all of us in the room started in this business. But what to do about it, I think, is a complicated problem that, as Michael says, most of us may go to our graves not having really unlocked. But huge progress being made as I look at places we work who are not necessarily flexible enough to program around all these issues, but are asking the questions. So you see this in, you know, in prosaic things like scopes of work and RFPs, and not that they've figured out, well, how do we integrate that into all the other things that we are constrained by, but they're working at it. And so, you know, they need our help and advice and pushback when they're, you know, they need our support in the same way that, you know, a reformer in Mexico needs support from the outside, from the, you know, picture with the ambassador. But it's, so I guess I don't worry about changing the way the whole world thinks. I worry about changing the way some worlds think, so that we aren't wasting our breath and taxpayer dollars on things that could be more successful if we thought about them in a little more nuanced way.
My name is Michael Moses. I'm from Global Integrity here in Washington, D.C. My question, I suppose, is for all of you, but specifically for Juan, based on your initial remarks. So, you laid out how you've taken this approach to thinking and working politically to get this policy or this law passed. And what I'm curious, so at Global Integrity, we do a lot of work to support closing implementation gaps, right? And trying to make the laws that are on the books actually effective. We take an adaptive learning approach to doing that a lot of the time. But I'm curious, in your experience in trying to get this law actually implemented so it's having the impact that it's intended to have, when you talk to policymakers or when you talk to civil society organizations, or when you talk to the people who call you and are like, hey, like, what's going on? Things haven't changed yet. What role does thinking and working politically, doing development differently, the insights of PDIA, adaptive learning, all of these different terms, how do they factor into the conversations that you have with people and with the work that you're doing now on the implementation side to actually try and get this law that you've worked very hard to pass, which has been a tremendous success, to actually make a difference in people's lives?
The specific question in Mexico, maybe there are some friends from the state of Illinois here. I read a bit about the political history of the state, and I have learned that if you are a governor of the state of Illinois, you have the professional risk to end up in jail. We need those traditions in Mexico because several state governors deserve to be in jail, and they are on the run or indicted without facing charges. One of them is on jail, but there are six or seven people that belong to networks that should be prosecuted that they haven't. And no matter what I say to people about that building long-term institutions is that what we should focus on, I'd say now we were gonna have these great databases where you could find the companies that are receiving contracts. Said, yeah, but where are these, when are these guys going to jail? I don't care about your databases. So we are giving very nerdy answers to tough political questions. If these guys, if there's enough political will and good prosecution process, and these they're not just the governors, it's a network of crooks behind them, but if they're managed to be prosecuted, we will gain so much political space and so much oxygen to start talking about databases without sounding that we're totally weird and out of touch with reality. So you need these kind of two cycles. You need like short-term results so people see that this political change, this legislative change are driven into results of what they are expected to see. Because we have free press and that's great. And we have all the information of all the things that these people did, but they are not being prosecuted. So it leads to a very frustrating combination of issues. A lot of information with no results. To how to use this information to transform reality, that has not happened. So I'm really looking forward that in the next couple of years, I could start talking about the importance of databases for government contracts without sounding totally out of the room and reality.
Jill Gay, What Works Association, for whoever is interested and willing to answer. How will our new president impact the work you're doing?
The tough question of the lady in the third row. Let's see what the story of the 21st century has been, or the one of the main critical moments of our century, of our current century. A fruit vendor in Tunisia was so fed up with police extortion and petite corruption that he decided to throw a can of gasoline and start basically the period of more political and security instability in a long, long, long time. You could see with not a lot of efforts connect the dots from Tunisia to Libya to Egypt to the Syrian war, and then with the war in Syria, all the migration crisis in Europe, and then the crisis with the UK, and then the frustration in other parts of the world, to not get myself into tough details. But that all started with a corruption case, a very small, petite corruption case. So I think if we want stable world, if we want political democratic political institutions to be sustainable, if we want peace, security, development, corruption should be a key issue on security policy, on global security policy, because it's in so many places, it's the first source of frustration with institutions. And maybe you could explain people that development takes time. You could explain people that fighting illnesses or improving standard education takes time. But when there are some crooks that it's evident of what they have done and the state authorities are not capable of prosecuting them, the degree of frustration is much more higher. So how could you sustain democratic institutions in the long term if you don't put corruption at the center, I would not say of development policy, of security policy, of diplomacy? It's kind of a Marshall Plan against corruption that will bring much more patience and space to different societies in the world to give development a second chance and more oxygen and time to bring results, as is happening to us in Mexico.
Of course, the opposite of corruption is transparency and accountability. So that's a good segue into the next session. But Melissa, I will give you the opportunity of the last word, and you've got 60 seconds.
Oh, that's not fair. I've never said anything in 60 seconds. I would maybe say two things. One, again, we've applied this work in many different contexts, from Madagascar to the Ebola response in Liberia to addressing maternal and newborn health in Indonesia. And in each of those experiences, even though we don't have time to go into them, it was clear that we learned about what the constraints were going to be to success. In sustainable fisheries, there was concern with the risk of violence and theft. In Indonesia, we had a much better understanding of why rates of newborn health were going up unexpectedly as child mortality rates were going down. In the case of the Ebola response, we were able, with emergency assistance, to adapt our programs to be more responsive to communities and what it would take to mitigate risky behavior in terms of Ebola transmission. And we were adapting very quickly. So we do have experience. I'm here today to tell you about our experience to date. In terms of looking forward, these are still early days. The administration is reviewing assistance, the breadth of assistance across the USG. And as with every administration, we will align to its priorities. Again, today I wanted to take this opportunity to lay out the sort of heritage of this work to date in the agency and our experience.